Hi everyone, I'm Jane, and today we're going to do a variation of Edvard Munch's The Scream. Make sure you check out the video description below for a full list of materials, and let's get started. The first thing I'm going to do is apply a colored ground, or an underpainting, and I'm going to use my 1-inch flat brush, wet it in my jar, and wipe the extra off. Now I normally wouldn't make you watch me do this, but I get a lot of questions about painting a colored ground or an underpainting. So I'm going to use raw sienna, and this is the Liquitex Basics. I just put it in this bottle because I bought it in a large tub, and I'm just going to squirt it right onto the canvas. Maybe. There we go. So I get asked a lot about why you should do a colored ground, what color to use, how to know if you should do it, and all kinds of questions. And so I think that applying a colored ground is really just a preference. You don't have to do it if you don't want to. What color you use is also up to you. Everybody has different preferences. So I don't always do it, but I do it when I feel like the painting I'm going to be doing needs a little bit extra color structure. And since a lot of the colors I'm using in this painting are going to be transparent, I think that extra structure is definitely needed. But another reason I'm doing it is because I'm going to be using a lot of contrasting colors with each other, and I want those colors to stay separate, so I don't want to overwork them by trying to cover the white of the canvas. So adding this colored ground lets me do that because I'm not concerned if this color pokes through my painting. Then I won't overblend my colors just trying to cover the canvas. Now you really can use any color you're okay with showing through. I know some artists always use, you know, they say you should always use yellow oxide or raw umber, something like that. But I know artists who use hot pink on every painting they do, or mint green, or whatever color they have left over on their palette from another painting. It really doesn't matter. It's just depending on what you want to see. So I'm okay with this color showing through my painting, so that's why I went with the raw sienna. So now I'm gonna get my blow dryer and just make sure this is completely dry, and we'll start blocking out the different sections of our painting. All right, now I've got my chalk, my canvas is dry, and we can start doing the blocking. I'm gonna start with the mountain. Now, one of the really cool things about this painting is the composition and the flow. So while I have a mountain shape like that, it's not just a single shape that separates the sky from the ground. That shape is also going to come around the edge here, down and out into our other shapes. So it's really a single shape. It's very fluid. And one of the things that that does is help draw your eye around the painting. Now notice that all of the elements in this painting lead right here to the middle where the scream is. And that, he's the subject, so he automatically draws your attention, but your attention stays on him because all of the elements bring you back to him. Then we're gonna have our pond, and I'm just gonna come off of here straight across at the top. It's fairly horizontal there, and just kind of a fluid shape. The boardwalk, and you can get a ruler if you're not comfortable drawing a straight line for the boardwalk. I'm just gonna draw it by hand. I'm gonna start a little bit below the top of the pond and bring it down at an angle. I feel like that's out too far. I'm gonna do that again. I'm not gonna worry about drawing the rails because we're gonna paint all this in, so we'll paint over the rails. We'll come back and do that later. So because I want to have all of these elements blend together just a little bit, at least the sky, the ground, and the bodies of water, I'm gonna lay out all the colors that I need on my plate right now, and I'm gonna do this fairly quickly. I'm also going to use matte medium, and what the matte medium is going to do is help me blend the colors a little bit, but also it will act as a little bit of a buffer so I can streak contrasting colors together without them mixing too much and getting too muddy. It's also going to help keep the paint open or wet longer so that I can get these different elements to blend. Now if you don't have matte medium, you can use gloss medium or even slow dry blending medium. I just like the texture of the matte medium a lot better than the slow dry blending medium. It seems to be a little bit silkier. It doesn't get quite as sticky. So I put out quite a bit, and notice it's white, but it will dry clear, so it won't affect the colors of our paint. I'm gonna start with my half inch angle brush. And I wet it in the jar and wiped it on the edge. But because I'm using the matte medium, I don't need as much water. So I'm just gonna lightly wipe it on a paper towel. I'm not trying to squeeze all the water out. I'm just drying it off a little more than I normally would. And I'm gonna start with the sky. So I'm gonna load up with my matte medium, kind of squishing my brush in there so that it gets inside of the bristles. And I'm gonna grab some orange, and I'm not really mixing them. I just kind of grabbed a little blob of orange. Now, all of the movements in the sky are more or less gonna follow the shape of this hill here. So I'm just gonna start on one side and start streaking some color in. And so you can tell that that orange is transparent. You can still see the color behind it a little bit. And that's one of the reasons I did an underpainting. My orange is a little bit old, so it's a little thicker than it should be. And I'm not filling in this entire sky with the orange. I'm leaving some parts of it blank. In some parts, the orange is thicker, and in some parts, it's thinner. One of the things I like about doing this painting is, even though it's based on an actual painting by Edvard Munch, you don't have to get real exact with it. You can put a lot of yourself into it. Interpret it however you want. Even Munch did this several times, and every time it's completely different. So I cleaned off my brush, just wiped on the paper towel a little bit, and let's get some yellow in there. So more medium, some yellow, and I'm gonna lay it in these areas where I didn't add any orange. Go ahead and let it go over the top of your mountain line. We're gonna blend into this sky just a little bit anyway. Just smooth, graceful shapes. Again, letting some of that yellow be heavier and some of it be thinner. And you can even grab a little hint of white, get some bright spots in there. Just make sure you don't mix it too much because the white with the orange is gonna give you a weird peach color. And unless that's what you want, just don't blend them too much. Now I'm just gonna get orange. I'm not gonna pick up any medium. There's a little bit of medium already in here, but the reason I'm not picking up any more medium is so that I can lay this orange on pretty heavy. The bright orange in the sky is one of the elements that really helps lend to the feeling of anxiety or fear that the subject is feeling. Super light pressure over hard lines will just help get rid of the hard line without blending it in too much or laying down more paint. Clean brush again. Wipe it on my paper towel. More medium, and we're gonna add our ground and mountain. So I'm just gonna grab some burnt umber, not mixing it again. And I'm gonna start flat and let it overlap my sky a little bit. Whoa. It doesn't have to be a perfect blend, but notice they just streak together a little bit. And don't be afraid to let it overlap your water a little bit too. Remember your brushstroke direction. So everything is gonna follow that shape. So it's gonna come up and around. And around the edge of the water. Just be very loose with this. Don't try to make it look a particular way. You know, I have a feeling just knowing how Munch worked and kind of looking at the painting and the whole anxiety feeling he was trying to get across, I have a feeling that Munch worked very very loosely and, you know, didn't try to make things happen a certain way. I didn't clean off my brush, but I got more medium and some of the cerulean blue. And I want this area here to have quite a bit of the blue in it. It's a nice contrast to our sky, but also it will make the scream guy stand out a little bit more. I'm not trying to cover all of the brown. We'll add a little up in here. And if you feel like you have too much, get a little bit more brown and streak it in there. I'm even gonna grab a hint of white. I just grabbed a tiny speck of white. See, just that tiny little dot of white. And my paint is quite thick here. A little more blue in there, and then I think I'm done with this part. Now I still have the blue and the brown. I'm gonna get a little bit more medium, and I'm gonna grab quite a bit of white, and we're gonna start adding the water. Because this water isn't pure white, so don't just use pure white. I'm gonna let it blend over the edge of the ground a little bit. And very light pressure there just to dust out those lines. I wiped off my brush, I didn't clean it, but that is just too hard of a line for me. So I'm just gonna grab a little bit of my medium, just medium, nothing else. And I'm gonna go over that line with my brush half in the pond and half on the land. And see how that softened it a little bit. Much better. A little more brown and blue, a little more medium, more white, and we'll fill in this area. Same type of thing. Remember, your brush stroke should follow the shape of the element. Right over top of that line. You can even go into it a little bit and back out. Really drag that color into here. Okay, that's really all there is to the background. I'm gonna let this dry because the boardwalk, since it's in the foreground, it wouldn't quite blend into all of the elements the way these do. Blending these elements in, I feel like, pushes them back a little bit farther and gives you that illusion of distance. So the elements here, the boardwalk and the scream, we want to have a little bit more sharp edges to it than what we have here. All right, so it's relatively dry here. Let's go ahead and start on our boardwalk. So I'm still using my angle brush, a little bit of matte medium, and I'm picking up some of those colors and it doesn't matter. And I'm gonna start with some blue, actually. Not a ton, just a bit of blue. And start kind of with the edge of my brush, not the flat part, start streaking some lines of the blue, and I can draw the line for the boardwalk too. Now, I'm not worried about my lines being perfectly straight, and that's because, like I said, it's a very kind of spontaneous type painting, and I almost feel like if these lines were too perfectly straight, you know, if I put them on there with a ruler, I feel like they would stand out, and I don't want that. So I'm just streaking some blue and some medium through here. I'm not trying to cover the entire canvas. Notice as I'm getting down toward the bottom more, I'm putting a little bit more pressure, getting some wider lines. And in the back, the lines are a little bit more narrow. More medium, and I'm gonna grab some orange. And I didn't clean off my brush. And the blue and the orange will definitely make a muddy color. However, this is gonna be a brown boardwalk, so it doesn't really matter. And I'm gonna focus on applying the orange right between the blue, right where the canvas is still exposed, or the underpainting anyway. Not trying to blend them. If you look at all of the different versions of the scream that Munch did, you'll see that every element is done differently in each painting. The boardwalk looks totally different in one. The water, the sky, the screamer, they all look different. And actually, most of them weren't even done with paint. They were done with, some were done with like pastels. One was done in tempera paint, all kinds of things. So I still have all the blue and the orange on here. And I'm just gonna wipe it on my paper towel. I'm not gonna clean it off. I'm gonna get some more medium. And some brown. And I might pick up a little hint of white too. Just a little pinpoint of white. And I'm gonna do the same thing and let these colors start to play together. If you want to use your brush flat to get some wider looking planks, you can do that too. Just make sure your brush strokes all go in the same direction. I know right now it does not look like a flat boardwalk, but as soon as we add the rail, it's going to magically push this down to make it appear that it's a flat ground. Keep a little bit of white in there. That way your screamer guy will stand out from the boardwalk. If the boardwalk's too dark, he won't stand out. I'm actually just gonna streak a tiny bit more white in there. All right, let's get our rails on there. Now again, if you need to let this dry so that you can use a ruler, that's perfectly fine. I'm just gonna go straight to it. For the base layer of the rail, I'm not gonna use any medium. I'm just gonna go right into some brown with a clean brush. Because we're gonna add some layers to this, so if this first rail is transparent, that's okay. So I'm gonna start my first rail about a quarter of an inch above the boardwalk here, and it's gonna end right about here. And I'm just using the edge of my brush. Remember, the tip of the angle brush always drags. And as I get farther down, I move farther away from the boardwalk. And I miss my mark a little bit, but that's perfectly okay. Because now I'm gonna widen it, but I'm gonna keep it narrow in the back. That's gonna help give the illusion that it's at the distance because it's more narrow. And as I come forward, I'm gonna slowly start putting more pressure on my brush to get a wider line. Okay, let's do our other railing. Same thing, I'm going to start about a quarter of an inch above that last railing, and I want this one to end roughly right there. Slowly getting farther away from it as we come down. And I'm going to widen it. Now, here's what's really going to help this seam, like a flat boardwalk with a railing. We're gonna add the vertical support posts. Now, when you do these posts, you wanna make sure that you don't come from here to an angle like that, because that's not gonna give the illusion that this is a railing that's standing straight up. So while this part angles as it moves away from us, the vertical supports would not. They would always be straight up and down vertical. So one way I like to do that is pay attention to the edge of the canvas and make sure that it follows that shape. And again, the one in the back is going to be more narrow than the one in the front. And my front one, I'm actually going to put my pinky right on the edge of my canvas so that as I bring my hand down, It can't really change shape because my pinky is bracing it there and preventing it from moving. So I'm gonna start here, put some good pressure on it, and straight down. Get rid of that blob. And see how that really flattens this out. Now, because these elements are in the foreground, we're gonna start adding a little bit more detail to them than we did in the background element. You know, I actually just realized I forgot to add our highlights in the water here. So I'm gonna take this little flat brush, some medium, and a little hint of orange, not a lot. And I'm gonna start streaking it over top. Now, even though this water is dry, using this medium helps make it look like it's blending in. Even though it's not. Just a little medium. It's almost working like glazing right now. If you feel like it's too heavy in any area, just clean off your brush. Get a little bit more glazing medium and kind of work over a spot where you want to take some of that color down a little bit. More medium, a little hint of yellow, and just super light pressure to dust some of that in. Just medium to get a little bit of a blend. Now, if you do this while the water's wet, it's much easier, but it's nice to know that you can do this and make it look like it's blending, even though the paint is dry and it's not blending. And if you decide that that's too much, you can get a little bit more of your white mixture, a little more medium, and you can go right over top of it to tone it down a bit. I'm not worried about my rail. We haven't added any detail highlights to it just yet. And if you feel like this water completely gets away from you and that you've muddied it up too much, then just let it dry, paint it back over with white, and come back. All right, going back to my angle brush, and I'm gonna get a hint of black, just a little corner on my angle brush, mix it with some brown, get a nice dark brown. And some medium. And we'll start adding the shadow to the bottom of these rails. So again, I'm just going right back over the rails. Just getting some of that darker brown in there. Again, don't worry about the white of the medium there. It will dry clear. But you want that medium there because when we start adding the highlights in a minute, you'll get a nice transition between the highlight and the shadow without having a hard line that you have to deal with. And let's do the same thing to the vertical supports. And we actually want to do that to this, to the bottom edge of the boardwalk here. So we're going to treat it just like a rail. Let's get some medium and add some orange highlight. Now, as the boardwalk moves away from us, we're going to put less highlight on it. That will help keep your attention drawn here, but we'll have it kind of fade off slowly. So I just have orange and some medium, and I'm going to go right along the top edge. And where that line is, if you angle your brush just a little bit to the side, and again, go half on and half off of that line, you kind of smooth it back in. So let me show you what I mean about smoothing that in. We'll do that on this lower rail here. So again, I'm gonna come right at the top with the edge of my brush, put some pressure on there, lay down that highlight color. And then that hard line, rather than going over it again the same way I just laid it down, I'm gonna turn my brush so it's slightly at an angle. Half of it is gonna be on top of the orange, half of it's not. And lightly streak down. And that gets rid of that line. And we'll do it on the bottom here. And then we'll move on and finish the rails. Keep a clean, slightly damp brush so you can wipe away any little blobs like that. Now I have very little orange paint on my brush, so it's automatically kind of fading the orange out as I get further back here. Notice also I'm taking my brush stroke right over top of the vertical supports. So what that is doing is it's pushing the supports to the other side to say that the rails are inside, the supports are outside. If you want it the other way around, just keep doing it the same way, but then go and add your highlights to it afterwards. I'm gonna let them be on the other side because it doesn't really matter. Clean brush, more medium. I'm gonna grab a hint of white, not a ton of white, just a little bit, and some yellow. And we're gonna do the same thing, just add some brighter highlights, and the yellow is not gonna go back quite as far as the orange did. So just right here at the top, blend it back just a little bit. I'm even gonna get some heavier yellow and just kind of streak it on the top edge here, really brighten that up. But again, this is my interpretation of this painting. I think as long as you focus on the fundamentals, the important elements, which I think is really the composition and the Scream Man. Those are really the important parts that make this painting. So as long as you make sure that you have those elements taken care of, you really can do this any way you like. Let's take care of some of these spots that got a little too dark. I'm just gonna grab a bit of brown and just lightly streak it over those highlights that took over my world. Here we go. So when I used to lead this painting and paint parties at my gallery, I actually had somebody who roughly did the background and the sky and everything. They use completely different colors, and I can't remember what colors they used, but the scream that they did was really just a face, and it took up the vast majority of the canvas. And that was really interesting. So, you know, don't focus on your proportions being exactly the same. Definitely don't focus on your colors being the same. The colors I'm using are my interpretation. You know, like I said, Munch really used all different kinds of mediums. He certainly didn't use cerulean blue acrylic paint or cadmium orange acrylic paint. That's just the interpretation that I have. Wipe some of that off. And get a little more shadow color in there because that highlight was a little intense. A little more solid yellow. Uh-oh. That's all right. Just tap it with my finger, and if it doesn't come off, I can either paint over it or make sure my screen guy covers it. My boardwalk's fairly dry, so I can pretty much just wipe that off. This one's really giving me some grief down here. That's okay, because, you know, you can change anything. So don't get hung up on things that you don't like. Keep working at them until they take care of themselves, or forget about it and move on. But I'm much happier with that. And you know, my scream guy is gonna be right here, and he's gonna cover a lot of that anyway. All right, let's add our scream's little friends. So I know a lot of people interpret these guys as being what he is screaming at, but actually these were friends that Munch was walking with one night when he had some kind of a vision to create this painting. So I'm using my angle brush, and it's pretty dry. I just wiped it on the paper towel until it was quite dry, and I'm not using medium, but I did pick up just a little bit of black, not a lot. We're really gonna just dry brush these guys on here, make them very, very simple. So I'm gonna start here with this one, and I'm just barely touching the canvas, kind of dry brushing it. See how that line is really broken? We're just gonna give an insinuation of these guys in here. I'm gonna come down, maybe out a little bit for a shoulder. And my brush was just a little wet, so I just wiped it on the paper towel again. Another little insinuation of a shoulder, and actually I'm gonna break up the sides of his head just a little bit. Super light pressure with a pretty dry brush to get fuzzy edges. And if you use too much paint here, you're just gonna get big black blobs. But if you wanted to spend more time and actually draw them out, you can do that. Munch did it several different ways. Just coming straight down for his legs. In some of them, he actually drew out people and gave them details. In one of them, one of the friends is even leaning over the railing. But the ones that I really like are the ones where they're just really insinuated. Maybe we'll give him a little bit of a hat. Just a smaller section on top of his head, a little bit of a brim. Same thing over here. Light pressure, getting really fuzzy lines, straight down for his body, out just a little bit for his shoulders. And maybe we'll give him a little bit of a hat too. Well, maybe not. I like just the hat on the one guy. Now I'm gonna grab a hint of blue, and I'm gonna give a little bit of a shadow to him. I know he's already black, and the blue is brighter than the black, but the way I interpret this painting is the blue is the shadow. So I'm gonna put this guy in the back in a little bit of blue. Just wipe that off. I don't need to be too precise with this. I'm gonna grab a little bit of orange and put a little bit of a highlight on this guy because he's closer to the water and the light source. Just super light. And if you decide you don't like this, just put some more black over it. Now that our sky is dry, I'm gonna add the little bits of blue in there. I didn't wanna do it when this was wet because I didn't wanna get any green or mud. I wanna make sure that the blue is completely separate from these colors. So my clean angle brush, a little bit of medium, and just a little bit of blue. I don't want to put too much in there. Just decide on a couple little areas where you want the blue and streak it in. And then you can grab a little bit more medium and go over that line and just kind of break it up. All right, I'm gonna get my chalk again, and we're gonna start on our scream guy. If you're gonna use chalk, just make sure this is fairly dry. Start by outlining where his body's gonna go. So I want his body to come just above the rail. I'm gonna make my guy a little bit bigger than Munch's. So this is gonna be the center of his body, about in a shape like that. We'll have his collar up here. come down around, follow that center shape. Whoa, make sure you follow that center shape. And we'll give him a shoulder or an arm. It's going to come down and swoop right back into his body. And same thing here, back up into his body. Clean angle brush and some medium. And I'm actually, well, that's pretty wet. That was pretty wet. You don't want to use a lot of water when you're using the medium, because the medium is going to help thin the paint out anyway. So I'm actually going to start with blue and just kind of streak some in. I'm not trying to fill the entire thing. Just about like that. More medium and some black. So this is kind of similar to how we did the boardwalk with the two colors, letting them streak together. Let's do his outline real quick. Make sure we do a line kind of like that to say that his arm is coming down around and reaching back up. I'm just going to add a little bit more blue in there. You can even add just a little bit of white if you feel like you need it. Right, now we're gonna spend quite a bit of time on his head and his face. So I'm taking my chalk again and I'm gonna roughly outline where I want his head to be. It's kind of a big, long oval shape. It's bigger at the top than at the bottom. And he's not a realistic looking guy, so don't worry about if his head is disproportionate. Munch's is very disproportionate. I think I'm gonna go a little bit bigger than that. I'm doing my guy quite a bit bigger than the original. Give him a little bit of a neck in there. Now I'm gonna use this 1/4 inch flat brush. I'm gonna get a little bit of brown. We're really gonna do some color mixing here. But get really creative with your colors. Like I said, the colors don't matter. So I'm gonna get some brown and some of this cerulean blue and mix it with some white. Now, if I just mix brown and white, I feel like it looks too pink. But the cerulean blue kind of helps cool it off a little bit and make it a little bit more of a gray tone rather than a fleshy tone. And let's see, I'm gonna make this one quite dark to start with. Some medium. And I'm just gonna outline his head. Look at the colors that Munch uses. He does not use realistic colors. In one of the versions that he did, the Scream's face is green and yellow. This painting is really about emotion, not realism. I'm gonna grab more white into that color, more medium, and fill this in. And as I swipe over the other color, they start to blend together a little bit with the help of the medium. Don't worry about blending out all your brush strokes. And let's get his neck in there. His neck is not really very important. And we'll do his hands. And his hands are very simple. Don't be afraid of drawing hands here. I'm gonna use the edge of my brush. I'm gonna start right up here next to his face. I'm not touching the edge of his face. There's a little bit of a gap. And as I come down, I'm gonna push a little harder so I get a wider line, curve around the side of his face, and back down and end in his body. Same thing on this side. Down around the edge, curve for his wrist, and down into his body. And we'll give him some sleeves to kind of cover that up. I'm just gonna block in a couple of shadows on his face now. So I'm getting that dark color again. And right about where his eyes are gonna be, I'm just gonna apply this darker color. You can get a little tiny bit of medium if you feel like you have too hard of a line that you want to blend out. Just a little bit. Now we're going to go to this very small liner brush. Sorry, I just realized that you guys couldn't see me mixing colors. I will make sure that you can see that from now on. So mixing up a lighter color, it's basically the color I used in the shadows for his eyes, but I'm mixing a little bit more white into it. I don't want to make his eyes pure white, but it's a pretty light color. So I'm going to come in here and start. I'm going to not draw a full circle just yet. Just lay down the base for the colors. Now maybe I'll get something closer to pure white. And do the other half. Just kind of streak them together. A little my darker color, that's a little too bright there. Now one other thing, I don't like having that hard line around the edge of his eyes. So I'm just gonna get a little bit of medium. I still have the color on my brush. But I just picked up a little bit of medium and I'm going to lightly swipe right over that line. I'm using almost no pressure. If you use too much pressure, you're going to deposit more paint. But we are going to add some more shadows and low lights in here. So if you get his eyes too big, you can cover them up. Let's go ahead and block in his mouth. So I'm still using my little brush and I'm gonna get some brown. And this cerulean blue is much stronger than the brown. So just remember that it will overpower the brown. But I'm gonna mix them together until I get a nice dark color. It can be a little on the blue side if you like. And we're gonna add the shape for his mouth. I like kind of a crazy elongated. Like that. Mix up just a little bit more. Really get that line nice and dark. Super light pressure. My brush is barely touching the canvas. I'm not putting full pressure. Even with this little tiny brush, if I put too much pressure on here, I'm gonna get a really fat line. So rest your hand on your canvas if you need to. See, look, let me demonstrate. If I put no pressure, I get a thin line. If I put full pressure, I get a fat line. So if your line is too fat, you're probably putting too much pressure on the brush. I'm gonna take that same color and give him some nostrils. They're just two dots. And the color of his eyes, I'm gonna use the same color. But because that paint is still pretty wet, well, it's sticking pretty good. I might touch it up again in a minute. A little more brown. And I think I'm gonna add some white. We'll get a bit of a shadow color for the inside of his mouth. But I don't want it as dark as his lips, because then it'll just look like a big dark spot. Now let's go darker than that. There we go. And it doesn't have to fill the entire thing. And you can keep adding paint and adding paint until you get exactly what you're wanting. And I feel like I'm even gonna go darker than that. I just don't want it quite as dark as his lips. And so to make sure that happens, I'm gonna add a little bit of black to this blue-brown mixture and just go back over his lips again. So what I want you to get out of this painting is playing with it until it is just what you want. You can experiment for hours and days and, you know, paint over elements and do them again. Don't settle for something you don't like. All right, let's get some shadows going in there. So I have this blue-brown color that has a tiny hint of black in it. And I'm gonna mix it with just a little bit of white. And get a bit of medium. And I'm just gonna start slashing it on his face here, right around his eyes. See, now I'm putting the fuller pressure on it to lay down more paint. Still light pressure right over the top of the edge of his eyes because I don't want a hard line there. Very, very light pressure. Up here, we're gonna insinuate some eyebrows. I'm not gonna draw eyebrows, make him look like he just got his brows waxed. A little bit of medium, only medium this time, and start streaking out those lines and blending the color in. Try to keep in mind where you think the shadows on his face would be, where you think that his face might be sunk in more. So definitely along this side of his nose would be a little bit more of a shadow, up under his brow ridge, maybe right here in his cheek, and along the side of his mouth. On this side, I feel like it would be kind of right here by his hand, under his brow, down here by his cheek again. But wherever you want to put him, there's not a right and wrong. That's just where I'm deciding to put these. So I'm going to add that same color roughly over here. A little medium. Just swipe over that line where it contacts his eye. And blend that line out. And we're gonna go back and add some highlight too. So this is not the end. So if anything looks crazy and too dark to you, that's cool. Just let it go. Don't stress it. Let's add a little of that shadow right in there. And you could even get really crazy and add some unexpected colors in here. Maybe some of the oranges reflecting on him, maybe some of the blue. Let's get some of that dark under his chin here. And now he looks totally crazy. And I'm not worried about what any of this looks like right now, because I know that I can change any of it. So if you're looking at your screen right now and you're like, whoa, buddy, that's cool. Just keep going. Don't stop. So now what I'm gonna do up here is just kind of slash the color on. Just get that off my brush. Then I'm gonna pick up quite a bit of medium and just swipe it in. Because that medium keeps the paint open longer, gives you a little bit more working time. Let's get a little of that darker color under this eye. And if you're not comfortable doing a lot of blending like this, then don't. You can make him be very simple. You can make him be a solid color if you like. It's your painting. You do it how you want to do it. And let's mix up a little more of that shadow color and put some on his hands. And a little medium. I'm going to put it on the inside of his hands. Down into his wrists a bit. Make sure that every so often you stand back and look at him. Painting little tiny details like this, you know, with a tiny brush, you can get a really myopic view of what you're doing. And while you're looking at it up close, you may think, oh, this looks great. And then you stand back and look at it and you're like, whoa, what have I done? So work on it for a little bit and then stand back and look at it. And that'll give you a better idea of where you need to adjust the shadows and highlights. I'm gonna add a little more shadow to his neck, and then I'm gonna stand back and look at him and decide what I need to change. I think it's time to start working in some of those lighter colors. So I'm just gonna mix what's on my brush in with some white, get a substantially lighter color, and some medium. And again, I'm just gonna kind of slash it on here wherever I feel like I want some highlight. Kick that part back a bit. That's where I'm gonna play with the highlights. Quite a bit of medium. And start smoothing it in. Just gonna smooth that line over his eyebrow. And right now, because I have all that paint down, all I'm picking up when I go back to my palette is medium. I'm not picking up any more paint. Super, super light pressure, barely touching the canvas. You know, I think I am gonna add just a little bit of blue into that. Let's get some kind of unexpected colors going on in there. I'm gonna wipe a bit of that off. I don't want that much paint on my brush. Just keep playing with the colors. Again, if you end up hating this, paint over it. Paint over his face. Do it again. Don't settle for something you don't like. There's not a time limit. You know, if you go over this 5 times and you hate it, go over it 6 times. Keep doing it until you like it. You know, settling for something that you don't like is absolutely not a requirement, especially in art. You know, I did this painting last week. I'm just taking a little bit of extra white and lightly with some medium going over that shadow. I just felt like it was too dark. Last week, I painted this and I filmed it and I edited it, the whole thing. And then I realized, you know what? I don't like it. And I mean, I allowed myself a moment of frustration, but I got over it, and here I am doing it again. And I'm much happier with it today. There, that looks better. I like that. So just a little paint and medium. Probably 50% medium to 50% paint here. and just super light pressure. Get a little bit of that highlight on his hands, and then we're going to zoom out and look at him at a distance, see what we think. But if at any time you're looking at your screen and you're like, wow, he looks weird, or he's ugly or disproportionate, and I want you to look at all of the versions of the screen that Munch did and see how different they all are and how weird the guy looks. In none of them does he look like a real guy. You're trying to convey emotion here. You're not trying to convey an actual portrait of a person. And you can help convey those emotions in the way that you use your shadows and your highlights. I'm gonna add a little highlight here to the bottom of his neck. And maybe deepen that shadow at the top just a little bit. Just kind of drag that dark shadow color down into his neck a little. But regardless of how you feel about how your scream turns out, I want you to take these techniques using a tiny detail brush and some blending medium to do highlights and shadows, and use that in your own paintings. Figure out how to incorporate that, because I think it's a very useful technique. If you really put quite a bit of time into it, you can push and pull shadows in anything to really make them just pop right out. All right, so except for the chalk lines around him, and we haven't done his sleeves yet, I think I'm feeling pretty good about the shadows and the highlights in his face. I'm just gonna finish up the bottom of his arms, put his sleeves up, and then we're about done. So I'm gonna go back to my little flat brush, just a little bit of medium, some black, and right at the bottom of his arm, I'm gonna take the edge of the brush and just make a line. Say that his arm disappears into his sleeve there. Pull it out here to that other line that I made. And then we can add a little bit of blue so that you can really tell where his sleeve goes. And then I'm going to sign him. And there's just one of a million ways that you can paint Edvard Munch's The Scream. I hope you enjoyed painting this with me, and I hope you feel inspired to get super creative with this, use different colors, and really do it in any way that you want to. I certainly didn't do it the way Munch did, and so there's no expectation on you to do it the way I did. Make sure you check out the video description below, where I will put a link to the Wikipedia page for this painting. In that page, you can find photos of some of the variations that Munch did on this painting to give you an idea of ways that you can mix it up. Also in the video description, you'll find links to where you can find me all over the internet, including our Art Monster Squad Facebook group, where you can share your version of this painting with me and our community. If you haven't yet done so, please make sure you subscribe so that you can paint with me every week. Thank you as always for watching, everyone, and I'll see you next time.